I'm Matt Eccles, the marketing director at TyTek Medical. And I know it's a different time there in the States, but those of us here in the UK, every Thursday at 8 p.m, we take to our doorsteps, socially distancing, of course, to clap for the carers and the frontline workers to show our appreciation of all the great work that they're doing throughout this pandemic. And I think that really resonates today on National Stop the Bleed Day. I just wanted to give you a little introduction into what you're about to witness and who TyTek Medical are. We have a battlefield heritage in sort of trauma care, but with civilians receiving military style injuries. We've brought ourselves into that space, and we don't see ourselves as an organization that merely sells products. In fact, genuinely, I hope you never have to open anything that you might buy from us. But if you have to, you've come to the right place, because we're problem solvers and we deal in partnerships, and we're really going to demonstrate to you on National Stop the Bleed Day how we're working with some really, truly, genuinely inspiring people. We have coming up for you Scarlett Lewis of the Jesse Lewis Choose Love Movement, and we've got Dr. Dustin Calhoun, who's an emergency physician in Cincinnati. And together, our plan is to educate, equip, and empower you to save lives. And we'd really welcome your feedback as we go along. So this will become apparent as we go through, and we're really going to be looking at two things: how to address the cause and the effect of bleeding control, and really bring that together as a solution to make the world a better place, let's face it. Now, just a quick gear change. Hands up if you dislike audience participation. Good, you're in the right place, because we have a prize draw today. One of our award-winning bleed control pouches will be awarded to the winner. We've got interactive polls as we go through this event, and you'll see those popping up. We don't want this to be a passive event. We genuinely want you to participate and be part of the proceedings. And Scarlett will be announcing the winner at the end. And the first polls come up there. How many states in the US have passed some sort of bleeding control legislation? So you can vote now, and I'm sure Ryan will bring the answers in his next session. But before I hand over, again, I just wanted to say a big thank you for joining. You know, you've taken a huge step to changing your way of thinking about how we address bleed control, even in these really strange times. These events are still happening. I'd like to thank sincerely Scarlett and Alexis at the Jesse Lewis Choose Love Movement, Dr. Dustin Calhoun, and I'd also like to thank the team at 1110 Creative, Steve, Jess, and Dan, who have made me look fabulous, which is quite some feat. So without further delay, I shall hand you across to my colleague and Director of Emergency Preparedness here at TyTek Medical, Mr. Ryan Burke. Ryan, over to you.
Thank you, Matt. So before we actually begin, a little bit of background on Stop the Bleed Movement, National Stop the Bleed Day. Following the shooting at Sandy Hook, Dr. Leavenworth Jacobs reviewed that incident from a medical perspective, and which led to meetings with the American College of Surgeons, and they called for additional meetings with emergency medicine physicians, EMS, government officials, and law enforcement to discuss how to improve survival rates for the victims of severe bleeding. Because these initial meetings actually occurred in Hartford, Connecticut, the recommendations became known as Hartford Consensus. These recommendations served as the foundation for the Stop the Bleed initiative to empower the average citizen to respond to severe bleeding. In 2015, the White House launched a national public awareness campaign and a call to action to begin training more people to become immediate responders. We're all familiar with the first responders, our fire, EMS, law enforcement, but the immediate responder are those citizens that are there at the incident that can, with some training and some equipment, be able to help save lives through stopping the bleed. On March 31st, 2018, the first National Stop the Bleed Day was established. And 3 years later, here we are today, virtually, to lend our support to help educate, equip, and empower people to stop the bleed through proactive and reactive measures. So at this time, I will go ahead and provide you, if you want to go ahead and answer this question. The first question was, how many states in the U.S. have passed some form of bleeding control legislation? Four. There have only been four states in the U.S. that have passed some sort of bleeding control legislation, and they include Arkansas, Indiana, Nebraska, and Texas. For your next question, according to the FBI, how many active shooter incidents occurred in the U.S. between 2000 and 2018? The answer is 277.
Being willing to be involved in this, it's really important that we all are able to sit down around our computers around the world and discuss this kind of thing. And then great thanks, obviously, to TyTek and the Jesse Lewis Choose Love movement for organizing this for all of us. I think something that Ryan mentioned that is really, really important is that concept of first responders and immediate responders. So we hear a lot, particularly in the news these days with what's going on, about first responders and how important they are to our society and what they do. I think it's also important to remember that concept of immediate responders, because no matter what the traumatic incident is that we're talking about, the first people on that scene are going to be the people who were there when it occurred. So whether we're talking about a mass shooting, or we're talking about a natural disaster or a car accident, whoever is there when it occurs, they're the immediate responders. And the better trained they are, the more capable they are of handling it, the better off the unfortunate victims and patients of that incident are going to be. So I think with that, I would use that concept to push to all of you the idea that take a course. Right. There are plenty of courses out there under the banner of Stop the Bleed. Now, most of them are low, or most of them are no cost through your. There's a number of ways to find them through the trauma services of your local hospital would be one way. But take that kind of course. That said, we're going to go over some of the really basic parts of it. Being good at this requires some training, some practice, some hands-on stuff, which obviously we can't do over the internet. But we're going to go over some of the basics. And I want to push to you that if the only thing you've gotten are these very basic pieces that we're going to talk about today, and then you have the unfortunate situation of being in a place where you could use those between now and whenever you're able to get the hands-on part, go ahead and use them. Right, there's very little that someone can do that actually is going to do harm to either the victim or themselves if they follow some of the basic concepts that we're going to talk about as we go through this. And one of the first basics, obviously, is the same with other things like CPR, right? It's still very, very important that people remember that not all the bad things that we have to deal with in society are related to trauma. There's still cardiac arrest out there. So getting basic CPR training is still important. So with those and with these kind of things, protecting yourself, wearing gloves, you know, a simple pair of exam gloves are inexpensive and pretty much easy to hide in a wallet, a purse, a pocket, pretty much anywhere. Have those with you to protect yourself. That's really the only way that someone can get very significantly harmed out of this. So we're going to go through some of the fundamental knowledge that you need to have to be responsible. Just to be a responsible citizen of the world these days is worthwhile to have this kind of knowledge. And some of that fundamental, it sticks with you. It's like riding a bicycle once you get used to it. And then the other part is some fundamental equipment, right? There are ways to improvise most of the things we're going to talk about, but to be efficient, to be effective, it's worthwhile to have some of these tools at your disposal, right? Gloves, there's no great way to improvise a set of gloves. You could possibly use another kind of glove, but there's no way to really improvise that. So that's a big part of it. Other things like tourniquets, things like that, you can certainly improvise those, and those are effective. They're just not as fast. They just take longer, and you really have to remember how to use them. Someone who doesn't practice that regularly is going to have a harder time doing an improvised tourniquet than they will doing some form of a of a commercially available tourniquet. So that's a piece of it. Some form of a pressure packing, a packing gauze of sorts. So we'll show you some examples of that. Something to keep that pressure inside. So once you've built that pressure up with the packing gauze, something to put on that like a pressure dressing. So we're going to show you pieces of those kind of things and how to apply those shortly. So in the immediate response phase, you know, whether you have these tools or not, the real name of the game here is pressure. Bleeding is controlled by pressure. Now, it doesn't take a lot of pressure. If you just have the blood vessel, it's really no harder to compress the blood vessel and stop the bleeding than it is to compress a straw on a table. The problem is sometimes that blood vessel isn't right on the surface. There may be a lot of tissue between you and the blood vessel. So we typically teach people to use quite a bit of pressure, basically whatever pressure you can safely apply to the area where you see the blood. Find where the blood's coming from and apply direct pressure well aimed at that spot. That's the answer. Now, a lot of times, though, when you have multiple people who need help or multiple injuries that need to be dealt with or need to move the patient around, that's not the most efficient way of dealing with it, though it is quick. So you need to have some other tools, and we tend to break the body out into three different areas of bleeding, and you see those on your screen there. We talk about limb bleeding, the arms, the legs. We talk about junctional bleeding, the places that the arms and the legs and the head sort of tie into the body, so your neck, your underarms, the groin area. And then we talk about the torso. And in each of those, we talk about different ways to manage taking care of that bleeding. Well, we're gonna try and be a little bit crafty here, and I'm gonna step out of the camera, and I'm gonna put my colleague that you saw a minute ago, Ryan Burke, here on my camera, so you can keep hearing me, but be able to take a look at some demonstration that he's gonna do as I keep talking about how we do this. I'll reintroduce you here to Ryan, and Ryan's gonna show us some of the techniques that I'm talking about here. Like a tourniquet. Tourniquets are pretty simple. Tourniquets would work on the arms and the legs. Now, tourniquets in our society have a lot of negative connotation, right? Everybody's heard that you put a tourniquet on and that's going to be the end of that limb that you put it on. Well, that is born out of ancient history from World War I, the Civil War, where we're talking about a very different kind of tourniquet with very little training and a very different setting. With modern commercial tourniquets following some of the basic concepts of tourniquets, these are very safe. We have good evidence that putting a tourniquet on, no real harm within about an hour or two, which in most of our settings is gonna be a safe assumption. So with tourniquets, you basically are gonna put that around the limb. It forms a loop. This is a particular kind called a cat tourniquet that's commercially available. It's a windlass style tourniquet. You see the little stick there that we turn. You find the wound and you put this right above the wound. You want it a couple inches above the wound. Ryan here is simulating that maybe it's right over the wrist. If you're not sure where the bleeding is, or there's a possibility that there's other bleeding, you may consider putting the tourniquet as far up the arm as you can. Now, Ryan's not going to demonstrate that because it's harder to get on camera, but you could put it all the way up to the underarm. And we basically tighten these down as tight as they can get, and then begin turning the windlass once you have all of that Velcro applied with this particular model. Each model has its own quirks, its own specific design. The important thing is to remember that this is very effective, but it is a bit painful. So we have to recognize that going in. That works well on limbs. It doesn't work very well with your underarm or groin or your neck, because those are areas that you can't get the tourniquet around or shouldn't put the tourniquet around in the case of the neck. So when we're talking about other wounds, like Ryan is gonna simulate with the limb that we have here, you would talk about packing. Now the idea of packing is to basically produce pressure. So when I first start packing this wound with this packing gauze that Ryan's showing you there, I'm putting that first bit of gauze right where the blood's coming out, and I'm putting pressure on that. And that alone should cause the bleeding to stop. From then on, all he's trying to do as he packs more and more gauze in here is to build up the gauze to keep the pressure in place where I put it in place with my finger at the very beginning. The idea is to get to the point where you have enough gauze in there and it's built up in every little crack and crevice to keep that pressure in place when I then move on to something like a pressure dressing. So Ryan's gonna cut it a little bit short here, assuming he's got it all in there. He's now gonna put 3 minutes of pressure, holding good pressure on that so that we can start to have some blood clotting. Once we've gotten through that pressure, we want some sort of pressure dressing ideally to hold this in place. Now you could just continue holding it in place, but you could also just continue to hold pressure with your fingers. So we're assuming you need to be able to move on here to another patient. So we put a pressure dressing on that nice and snug. And that's how we control bleeding on the junctions or the groin, the neck, those kinds of areas. Putting something in like Ryan just simulated there with a bottle of water sort of changes the angle of your elastic bandage and gives you a little bit better pressure over what you're talking about. And that can give you some pretty significant advantages as well. So those are the three areas of bleeding, or the two areas of bleeding we talk about. When you talk about torsos, they're much more complicated. These are wounds that really need to get to a trauma center to have taken care of that way. With that, I hope that gives you some good basic information about what we're talking about here, working through some of the ways to control bleeding. Enough basic information where if you had to deal with this, I think everybody who's listened, if you're paying attention, probably could. But again, hands-on experience is really the way to go. Definitely encourage everyone to reach out, try and find that bleeding control, stop the bleed course near you to get just some extra experience with it. But the bottom line, please don't hesitate. This is something that everyone should know. And this is something that everybody should be willing to step up and use because it does, it has, it will save lives. Thank you for the time to talk about that a little bit. And please let the folks at Jesse Lewis, Choose Love Foundation, Movement, and TyTek, let us help out when you have questions with what you need to be able to enact this in your area. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Calhoun. So TyTek does have three primary products for bleeding control. We have pouches, stations, and kits, the contents of which we have selected specifically because they are evidence-based and or supported by the Committee on Tactical Combat Casualty Care, who are the experts in these type of wounds and the treatment of these type of wounds. So our standard bleeding control pouch does come with two sets of packing gauze, a 6-inch trauma compression bandage, a CAT tourniquet, two pairs of gloves, because as the doc said, you do have to protect yourself, a pair of shears so you can remove clothing to see the wound and visualize the wound, and an instruction card. If you elect to go to our enhanced pouch, it does add a chest seal. I will note that chest seals should really only be utilized by persons with specific training in the use of chest seals, because if you inappropriately apply a chest seal, it could negatively impact the patient. Additionally, we also add an emergency blanket. And I'd like to take a minute to kind of discuss hypothermia in a trauma patient. You know, we all understand in the wintertime in North Dakota, it's probably 10 degrees outside on the highest day. And we think hypothermia, we think of taking care of patients and keeping them warm. But trauma patients can become hypothermic in any environment that is below normal body temperature, 98.6 degrees. For every degree Celsius of body temperature loss, your body loses about 10% of its clotting factors. So the colder you get, the more you bleed, and the more you bleed, the less clotting factors you have, you bleed more. So it's just a downward spiral. So it's extremely important to keep people warm. Think hypothermia, even in the summertime in Miami. Our ultimate pouch, we do swap out one of our packing gauzes for a hemostatic gauze. If you prefer to have that in your kit as well. Additionally, besides pouches, we do have our bleeding control station. Our bleeding control station is unique, that is, it's only 4 inches deep. What that means is it does comply with the 4-inch ADA protrusion rule without the cost and expense of recessing a kit into a wall or limiting yourself as to where you can place it because of the size of the station. Each station does come with a quick litter in case you have to move a patient. Additionally, our stations either come with 6 or 8 individual kits inside each station. Scarlett, I do believe you are back with us now.
I think everybody can hear me. Thank you so much. I am so sorry. My internet went out, so now I'm on my hotspot, but I am going to go ahead and share my screen and go back to where we were before. Thank you so much for your patience. Grateful for all of you. I also want to say, mentioned a few more names. I'm so grateful for Majid Khan. He is the one that introduced me to TyTek Medical. He is our Choose Love ambassador in the UK. So he is responsible for spreading the movement. That's how we've spread the word, by the way. By mouth, we're now being taught in every state. In some states, we're the most taught SCL program and over 100 countries. And we've done this all by word of mouth through ambassadors, people that are very passionate about what we're trying to do and want to come in and help. They're volunteers, and that is certainly Majid. So thank you so much for introducing me to this wonderful group of people. I also want to thank Bishop Desmond Jadu of Yes to Life. He has really been supportive and helpful to Majid in the UK by empowering people in the inner city of Birmingham with the knowledge and ability to try to save a life. And trying to save lives both externally, as you've been hearing about with bleed kits, as well as internally, which is what I'm talking about, creating safety and saving lives from the inside out. And I'm going to go into that a little bit more in just a moment. I also wanted to say thank you to Elena Cohen from the Parliamentary Office of Khalid Mahoud, a member of Parliament, both of whom I've met and have spoken with in the UK and are huge Choose Love fans and are helping us spread the word over there. Thank you so much. I have a short 4-minute introductory video that I would like to show you, and then I'm going to come back and talk just a little bit more about the movement to choose love. But I do want to say that what I realized after the Sandy Hook tragedy, and by the way, we're all realizing now, right in the middle of COVID-19, is that really, as human beings, we're all connected. First of all, by the want and need to love and be loved. We all need that. It doesn't matter how old we are, what stage of life, we all need to love and be loved. And we all feel pain and suffer. We're all susceptible to COVID-19. So that brings us even closer together. Yet we all just want to live meaningful, purpose-filled, happy lives. And that's what we're talking about. We actually have a method to do that. And you will have that by the time I'm done. Okay, here we go. Love those moves. Awesome, Jess. It is August 24th, 2012. And Jess has brand new soccer shoes.
So prior to 12/14/2012, I was a single mom with two boys. It was kind of an unremarkable life. It was such a great life. You know, I just wanted to be a mom, and I just wanted to be with my kids.
Run the ball up to me.
One day, you're a mom with two boys, one boy riding in a car seat in the back seat. So one morning, I'm holding hands with my six-year-old in his car seat, and the next thing that I know, there is no six-year-old. He's been murdered. Through the kitchen on my way out, and I noticed these three words that Jesse had written on the kitchen chalkboard shortly before he died. He wrote, "Nurturing, healing, love." These words were a message of comfort for his family and friends and inspiration for the world. It's where we needed to turn. And I knew I'd be spending the rest of my life spreading this message. I didn't have to create a solution. There was one available, and it's called social emotional learning. And social emotional learning proactively prevents violence. I believe that Jesse is a part of this organization. I actually believe that he's leading it. And all I have to do is just be present. I live with a tremendous dichotomy in my life every single day. It's never out of my mind why I am leading a worldwide movement to choose love. It's because my six-year-old son was shot in his first grade classroom. Alongside 19 of his classmates in one of the worst mass murders in U.S. history. I feel like I meet Jesse a lot in schools. I'll look into a child's eyes and I'll see Jesse looking back at me. How blessed am I, and how grateful I am that my purpose is spreading a message of choosing love and given to me by my six-year-old son. So I like to follow that video up with a quote by Nelson Mandela, "People must learn to hate." And we know this through science, by the way. Everything I'm going to talk to you about in the next 5 minutes is all based in science and the latest neuroscience. And we know that babies are born, all babies, by the way, gravitating towards love. That means that they have to learn to hate. And if they can learn to hate, they can be taught to love. For love comes more naturally to the human heart than its opposite. Now, this is a message that started the whole Choose Love movement for me. It was a few days after the tragedy when I finally came home to my little farmhouse that I shared as a single mom with my two boys. And I found a message that Jesse had written on our kitchen chalkboard shortly before he died. He wrote three words: nurturing, healing, love. Now, I was floored, as I'm sure you are. Those words are not in the vernacular of a six-year-old. They were phonetically spelled because as a first grader, he was just learning to write. But those words are in the definition of compassion across all cultures. And I knew instantly that if the shooter had been a former student of Sandy Hook Elementary School, had been able to give and receive nurturing, healing love, the tragedy would never have happened. It was as simple as that. And so I knew that I'd be spending the rest of my life spreading this message. I wasn't exactly sure what this would look like. I was hooked up with a doctoral professor, the director of the Compassion, Creativity, and Innovation Center at Western Connecticut State University, who is actually the one that told me those three words are in the definition of compassion. And they also comprise a powerful and profound formula for choosing love in any situation, circumstance, or interaction. This is the basis for all of our lifespan, next generation programming, by the way. And I asked him, how do I get this into schools? And he told me it's called social and emotional learning. Now, social and emotional learning are what I was talking about before when I got cut off, learning how to have healthy relationships, how to manage our emotions, how to make good decisions, how to be resilient, the skills and tools that we're not born with, we have to learn. We know through research that this reduces and prevents violence. It reduces and prevents a lot of the issues that we're suffering from, yet less than 10% of schools in the U.S., at least, are teaching social and emotional learning in the way that it needs to be taught to be effective. By the way, 90% check off the box by saying that they do a week-long kindness program, have a speaker, do an after-school program or a workshop. All of those things are wonderful, but they actually do not impact culture, and they do not make lasting change, and they do not add to safety for the most part. So our premise in the program is that we can't always choose what happens to us.
wow, isn't that for sure? Even in COVID-19, nobody would ever choose that, but we can always choose how we thoughtfully respond. And when we choose love in our thoughtful response, kindness, caring, concern, compassion, civility, we take our personal power back. We make the world a better place. When we react with prolonged anger, hatred, and revenge, we give our personal power away. We actually become victims, which is the definition of loss of control. And that does not feel good. So our thoughts and beliefs make up our perception of our reality. We have control over our thoughts. So we focus on what we can control. Then we can be responsible for our healing and become a victor rather than a victim. This is how we take our personal power back and cultivate safety, physically and psychologically, as well as a more peaceful and loving world. And by the way, this isn't just for kids. If you've gotten that right now, it's for adults as well. We have so many issues that we face, and not just tremendous violence in the US and around the world. In fact, in the US, 2018 was the deadliest year on record for school shootings. Now, that actually came as a surprise to me as well, and I'm kind of in this space because we don't always read about it. It's not always a huge mass shooting, but we have school shootings on a regular basis. It's unfortunately become our new normal, but we also have other issues as well. We have a mental illness epidemic where almost half of our US students will have a diagnosable mental illness by the time they're 18. We've got so much trauma in our schools. We now have, depending on what state you live in, between 38 and 50% of kids coming to school having experienced a recent traumatic event. Bullying is increasing. Suicides are increasing. Our youthful suicide rate has doubled within the last 10 years, and we're having more and more suicides, younger and younger. And by the way, this is despite what we're addressing in schools for suicide prevention and awareness. Substance abuse is skyrocketing. We had more deaths from drug overdoses last year than ever before, and that number is supposed to escalate over the next 5 years with the pandemic. I don't know what that's going to look like. And we have drug awareness programs in schools. Loneliness is at epidemic levels. Pre-pandemic, I can't even imagine now. We have so much research on the deleterious effects of loneliness. We actually know that loneliness can cause death. And so, you know, all of these things, a lot of these things we know about, we're tracking them upwards. They're all epidemics and they're all getting worse, despite what is seemingly our best efforts. And I can tell you why, actually, right off the bat. It's because we focus on the issues that we're seeing. And it's kind of just how we're wired to do. It's okay, our brains are actually wired for survival. And that is not necessarily a bad thing, but it gives us a negative bias where we focus on the negative. We're also very reactionary. So we wait for a problem to occur. And once it does, we focus on it. What happens when we focus on something? It grows. This, what I'm talking about with choose love and social emotional learning, is a different way of looking at it. It is a proactive, preventative way of looking at it. Matt addressed this in the beginning. It's addressing the cause of all of those issues, including violence. And therefore, it is a solution to it, which is pretty exciting. There are decades of research behind social and emotional learning, and 100% of the research is positive. In fact, it shows that it positively can address, reduce, and prevent that entire list that I just went through. It's absolutely incredible. You can see now why I quit my previous job and dedicated my life to spreading this message. So I wondered, gosh, I'm not the only person that knows this. How come every child doesn't have this? And then I realized that cost was a big factor. In fact, my son, Jesse, was priced out of the market in Sandy Hook, Connecticut. And this is, you know, this is kind of a nice area. And we didn't have enough money to train our teachers to do it. So I, you know, this for me is a basic human right, these skills and tools. They're so vitally important. Kids will grow up and use them in every aspect of their life. including in their families, the families that they have, in their workplace, everywhere. So we created a program, and we were looking for a program that really included everything, the best of the best, what we know is statistically effective and evidence-based, and there really wasn't a program that had everything in it, so it requires schools to buy multiple programs, and it's too much for them to do too. So we put everything, the best of the best, in one program, and we made it no cost. So we call it Next Generation, a lifespan programming. And we literally include the best of the best and made it easy to teach, easy to learn. No teacher training required. They learn right alongside the students. And it's something that we practice then for the rest of our lives. And here is our wheel, and it's really extensive. We include social and emotional learning, but also character education, neuroscience, mindfulness, growth mindset, grit, positive psychology, post-traumatic growth, and resilience. And what we have to start with the self. You have to start by loving yourself, and then you can spread that love out to other people. So we start with the self, then go to classrooms, schools, homes, businesses, and communities. So we have it all covered. There has to be a consistent message. Within the last 4 years since the release of this program, it's now being taught in all 50 states in the U.S. and over 100 countries. So we're positively impacting millions of students and individuals by word of mouth. And by the way, it's fun, fast, and easy. It's not that big a deal. You can go to our website, chooselovemovement.org, and download the curriculum for your grade level. If you're an educator, if you're a parent, there's programming for you. If you're in a community, there's programming for you. If you're in a workplace and you're interested in that, we have a workplace program and people that run that division. And so we have a little bit of everything. Let's talk about school safety really quickly, because this is incredibly important. Obviously, we'd rather not have any of this happen. We'd rather reduce and prevent the violence before it happens. So I have two San Diego parents, really good friends of mine, that run Safe and Sound Schools, the top school safety organization in the world. They have the top school safety experts on their board of directors. They do a survey every year. They sent me their 2019 survey. They thought I'd be interested. They survey all of the top stakeholders in the education world, and they found that the top three safety concerns were: one, active shooter. This was in 2019. Number two, bullying. And number three, intruders. Then they ask all the top stakeholders, well, what do you want to see? Parents and educators wanted to see more security. So you've got the external safety measures, active shooter protocols, door locks, single point entries, school resource officers. And they wanted to see that. It made them feel safe. Educators wanted more mental health, but both, for number two, wanted to see social and emotional learning. Social emotional learning cultivates safety from the inside out by teaching these skills and tools. In fact, there was a report after Sandy Hook called the Sandy Hook Advisory Commission Report. This group was given the responsibility of finding out how something like Sandy Hook could happen and what we could do to make sure it doesn't happen again. And after 2 years of unprecedented access to everything, they came up with three things in no particular order. More gun safety, more mental health help, and then also social and emotional learning. In fact, the report says every school, pre-K through 12th grade, should have a comprehensive social emotional learning program taught with fidelity. That means embraced by all. I don't know if you guys have seen this chart. It's used by departments of Homeland Security across the country. And this is the pathway to violence. And the pathway to violence usually starts with a grievance and then ends in an attack. Now, remember I told you how we're wired, right? We're wired to be more reactive. We focus on the negative. So we've actually focused on that attack end and hardening schools, as you know. And what we realize now, the most important part of school safety actually occurs on the other end, and that is school culture. Because if you have a loving, kind, compassionate, connected school culture that can prevent a grievance from ever happening. Or if one does, because they do, you are giving educators and students skills and tools that they need to manage that grievance before it becomes an attack. So this is what an expert says about the importance of school safety. Why is school culture important? Positive learning can only take place in a positive culture. A healthy school culture will affect more student and teacher success than any other school improvement effort currently being employed. School culture is so vitally important. The number one way to have a good school culture is a comprehensive year-long social-emotional learning program taught with fidelity. Now, actually, our U.S. government came out with a final report of the Federal Commission on School Safety in December of 2018. Chapter one is character education, proactive prevention. And the Jesse Lewis Choose Love movement is mentioned in chapter one, along with social and emotional learning. Thank you so much for listening.
An extremely amazing program, Scarlett. Thank you for sharing that with us. If I could I get all the panelists to pull back up? So that way we can answer some questions that have come in and have been asked of us in advance. Matt, Jennifer in the UK asks, how do we get the government backing to get knife crime education and prevention into school settings?
Okay, first of all, can you hear me okay?
Gotcha.
Wonderful. It's a tricky question, super tricky question. Now, as I said at the beginning, and I think as Scarlett's demonstrated there, we're really all about looking at the cause and treating the effect of, you know, knife crime, gun crime, all sorts of violence, and ultimately how to control a bleed. We've got a real strong evidence base for that. There was a drive-by shooting in London not 2 weeks ago where one of our kits was actually used and taken from a nearby youth club to stop the bleed of someone who'd been shot in the street before the emergency services arrived. So there's the evidence base that it works there straight away. So we need to take that evidence into the heart of, you know, our governments. And we're doing that here in the UK, as Scarlett said, with Majid Khan, who's the UK ambassador for the Jesse Lewis Choose Love movement. We're doing that with Citizen Aid UK, an amazing movement that we've got Mike Robinson in the audience today. So hi Mike, and thanks for your partnership. We're also working with the Daniel Baird Foundation. Now Lynn has a very similar story to Scarlett, and all of these people are great influencers with roads straight into decision makers. And that's something that we as an organization, which I said right at the top, we don't just sell your product. We want to be part of the bigger solution. So we're going to keep lobbying, we're going to keep building partnerships, and we're going to maintain our efforts to make sure that, you know, the strength and unity and the loudness of our voice, if you will, just continues.
Outstanding. Thank you very much. I had a question come in as we were going through the presentation from Vicky. She asked me to repeat the information I provided about hypothermia. For every degree Celsius in temperature the body loses, the clotting ability or the clotting factor drops about 10%. So at 5 minutes, 5 degrees Celsius drop would decrease your ability to clot 50%. Hopefully you're still in the room and got the information. Scarlett, Stacy in Ohio inquires, how can we be more involved with our communities and spread the message?
Thank you so much, Stacy. We have a lot of opportunities. You can go on our website and read about our ambassadors and our advocates. We have somebody that leads that effort. Her name is Nisa Talavera. And if you type in your email address, we can have her reach out to you and start the conversation and set maybe up an online event just to get the word out. We really appreciate your interest.
Excellent. I had a question come into me regarding legal issues with non-medical providers rendering medical care. A very reasonable question in our litigious society, unfortunately. But fortunately, and let me preface this with, I am not a lawyer. Our states have Good Samaritan laws, and the Good Samaritan laws generally will protect immediate responders who are not receiving any kind of compensation to render care or assistance in life-threatening situations, as long as they are providing care that a reasonable person would provide in that situation. So as long as a bystander is not trying to perform brain surgery on the street, I think the Good Samaritan laws will aid you and protect you from being sued for rendering that assistance. So again, check your local state's Good Samaritan laws to see just how far they go to protect you. Next question we have goes to Scarlett. Carol in Wyoming wants to know, how do we get your program adopted into our school system?
Oh, thank you so much for that question. You can do it many ways, but the easiest way is for you to take that message, the awareness, to your administration, and they can go to our website and you can access the programming right there. It doesn't need training. It's pretty straightforward. It's very straightforward and very easy. We did that on purpose. But I am always available to do an introduction for the educators, or even to do a presentation for the administration if they want that. If you have a contact, please write it in, or you can email me at scarlett@jessielewischooselove.org, and I will get in touch with them. We will work with you to get it in place. Absolutely.
Excellent. Yeah, great question, Carol. We definitely want to see this program in as many schools across the country and internationally as possible. So since we're a little bit over time, we're going to go ahead and move on to how do we get involved. To get involved with, and we'll provide you a slide here momentarily with all of our social media contact information, you can get involved by just reaching out to us. You can get involved by reaching out to your local trauma center, your local fire department, inquiring, do you have Stop the Bleed training? How can I help with Stop the Bleed training? For those of you who are medical professionals, EMTs, nurses, doctors, physicians, assistants, once you've taken this training, you can then go forth and train others within your community. So getting involved is very, very easy. You just have to have the desire to do so. Before I pass the reins over to Scarlett, who will wrap us up and select a winner for our award-winning bleeding control pouch, I just wanted to give the quick answers to the remaining three poll questions. If your patient has two wounds, one needing a tourniquet, one needing wound packing, which would you complete first? And the answers we showed you are very common answers we get, which is closer to the heart, whichever's bleeding more. But the actual ideal answer is, if you have one that you can tourniquet and one that you can pack, you throw the tourniquet on first, because the tourniquet is the fastest bleeding control option, and then you begin packing the wounds. What is the platinum 10 minutes? Well, that is the concept that a seriously injured trauma patient should have no more than 10 minutes of scene time or scene care before being transported to a trauma center as quickly as possible. And then, which element of the bleeding control kit would you use first to stop a bleed? Well, your gloves, because you always want to protect yourself and keep yourself safe first. So thank you so very much for your time and attention. Scarlett, you have the final word.
Thank you. I'm going to share my screen again, Alexis, if you will give me permission to do that. Thank you. Okay, I do want to just talk a little bit about Jesse. You saw in the video that He saved 9 of his classmates' lives before losing his own for that act of bravery. He's on the short list for the Presidential Medal of Freedom, not honor, freedom. It is the highest civilian honor for his act of bravery. For that also, he was given a commander-in-chief funeral. A commander-in-chief funeral is reserved for heads of state and returning war heroes. Jesse was actually considered a war hero because his first grade classroom, those two first grade classrooms where 20 first graders died, was a literal war zone. I mean, that's why we're having this webinar today, because the injuries that we're seeing are war style injuries and they really require immediate assistance, and it actually can save lives. So I wanted to talk about Jesse's heroicism, because that is the same courage that we all have within us. We all have the courage that Jesse showed on his in his final few moments. Science tells us that courage is like a muscle. We can grow it, but we all have that courage. Jesse was a 6-year-old little boy. He doesn't have anything that each one of us doesn't have. I mean, we all have Jesse's courage. We just have to be aware of it. And by the way, that hopefully we'll never be called to lay down our lives for our friends like Jesse did, but that courage can be used to actually be part of the solution, to do something to make sure, to help us spread this really vital message about bleed kits, which I completely believe in. I believe that they're extremely necessary. I have them in our cars, in our home, and I hope that every single school obviously should have them. They should be everywhere. If you can save a life, then we need to. And I believe in social and emotional learning, hopefully reducing and preventing that from ever happening and us needing to use the bleed kits. There's something that are there, we don't want to use them, but social and emotional learning is the best way to do that. It can reduce and prevent almost all of the suffering that we're seeing in so many different ways, including violence. So I really want to thank you for that. I would like to now announce the winner of our bleed control pouch. The winner is Amy Miller. Congratulations, Amy. I'm so happy that that you're the winner. But you know what? Everyone that joined us today on the webinar is really a winner, because you walked away with valuable knowledge. You are closer to being able to save a life, reactionary and proactive. So the challenge is to cultivate the courage that it takes to speak out, to do the right thing, and to help us spread this message. I'm so thankful to everyone for joining us today.
And thank you, Scott. And I'd just like to conclude that we will be sending out a recording of this session to everybody who's joined, to everybody who's registered. So please look out for that, and the various other offers and bits and pieces will be contained in that email. Ryan, was there anything you wanted to add, sir?
No, if anybody has any further questions or needs any assistance with training, equipping, or anything, please feel free to reach out to me directly, ryan@tytechgroup.com, ryan@tytechgroup.com.
Thank you all again so much for joining us. We'll see you soon.
Take care, everyone.